appointed APEC leaders to focus on economic synergy and cooperation on this year's APEC.
Welcome to Boracay, the Philippines' most famous beach.
We have covered the journey of our young democracy. In ANC, we were witnesses to the defining moments of Philippine history that influenced the world.
To the service of the nation.
We talk to leaders. We don't shy away from difficult conversations.
ANC Leadership Series.
We don't just tell stories. We tell you why they matter. We sift through the noise and arm you with facts.
Your biggest stories.
We report about disruption and how the latest technology and innovation have changed the way we live.
Told stories about crisis, but also about opportunities that came with it.
The Philippines.
And we are ANC.
Violence returns to the streets of Hong Kong. The UN chief also urging world leaders to take the lead in the fight against climate change.
Carmina Constantine bringing you the latest news Monday to Friday at 12 noon on Dateline Philippines.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Welcome to Matters of Fact. I'm Christian Esguera. Today in the program, we're going to talk about the Ombudsman's dismissal of this complaint against members of the Manila Police who kept 12 prisoners in squalid conditions. Now, this was discovered in 2017. They were kept in a very small space hidden behind a bookshelf. What many thought was an open and shut case turned out to have more complications, at least as far as the Ombudsman was concerned. First, the news, the Office of the Ombudsman, as mentioned, has dismissed criminal and administrative complaints against Manila police officers for detaining suspects in a secret cell with no ventilation. The Human Rights Commission filed those complaints after it found 12 people camped in what it described as a dark, dingy, and fetid space behind a bookshelf during a raid of the Rahabago police station in Tondo back in April 2017. The CHR said the detainees were unlawfully arrested, not subjected to inquest proceedings, not fed, and were to be released only if they paid the police. The agency also noted that the jail cell had just one male urinal, forcing some detainees to relieve themselves in plastic bags. But in a 10-page decision, the Ombudsman ruled there was no proof of bad faith on the part of the authorities when the detainees were placed in cramped quarters. The Ombudsman added, the CHR failed to prove the suspects were held beyond the period allowed by law and that the cell lacked necessary facilities such as toilets. To talk more about this case that they filed against the members of the Manila Police, who are joined on the program by Commissioner Karen Dumpit of the Commission on Human Rights. Good morning, Commissioner, and thank you for joining us on the program again.
Morning, Christian.
Okay, bad news for the Commission on Human Rights. You heard or you read the decision coming from the Ombudsman. First, I'd like to get your reaction to this. The Ombudsman said there was no showing that the respondents did so in bad faith. What do you say to that?
Well, actually, you know, in our view, bad faith is immaterial. Because when you take a look at the Anti-Torture Act, the fact that they were inside a very cramped space, dark, dingy, as you recalled, commingling of both female and male persons in custody is already a violation. In fact, when you take a look at it, when we first went there, we looked at the registry, these 12 people inside a 1 by 5 meter space that's very dark, no access to a bathroom facilities and all that, it's already a violation. They were not registered in the logbook as well. And that's okay. The first order of the day. When you arrest and bring them to a detention facility, you're supposed to register them. They weren't registered at the time that we went.
There's a tendency for people to think that the dismissal by the Office of the Ombudsman had to do only with the fact that there was no showing of bad faith, supposedly, coming from those respondents, meaning members of the Manila Police. But there are other things that were attached to this issue. You mentioned, for example, that they were not registered on the logbook in the first place. So give us a context, what you found out, why they were found in that particular cramped space, hidden behind a bookshelf in the first place. Why were they there?
Well, because they said that it was a receiving area. I think that was the word that was used. It was a receiving area. It was a holding area. But then we were also saying that several hours at the very least, if we were going to believe the police officers who were involved, that they were part of an operation that was undertaken and the arrests. They arrived at the detention facility, I think, if I recall correctly, about 4:30 a.m. But when we visited that place, when the surprise visit was conducted, it was already, I think, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, if not 6, no? If I recall correctly. And the first order is really, when you bring a person to a detention facility after an arrest, you're supposed to log it. But when we went there, in fact, when Attorney Boy Sir, our then regional director for NCR, knocked on the bookcase and said, please open this, they were hesitating, in fact. So if it was part of their facility, then they could have easily shown that to the inspecting team.
Okay, so just to be clear, there was an effort on the part of the members of the Manila Police in that precinct to conceal that facility, quote unquote, that they had prisoners kept in that facility.
The videos will not lie. We can always review the videos that we presented as evidence as well. If you remember, the media was part of this, not necessarily part of the team, but the media covered the surprise visit. And this was based on a tip that we got from the families, one of the families, I suppose, of those detained. No?
Okay. When you got that tip coming from one of the members of, one family member of one of those being kept in that cramped space, what did that person tell you? What was the primary complaint? Why he or she went to the CHR?
The description, if I recall correctly, is parang it's like a cash cow. They would keep them there and then they would extort money to say, okay, we won't file the cases and you will be let go. That's why wala sa registry din eh. That supports the this particular opinion actually is supported by the fact na bakit wala doon? Why is it not found, or the names of these 12 are not found in the registry? Just to recall as well that there was, when we discovered this, no, just to be able to describe to you visually what we saw there. So we entered and then we saw this bookcase. We were able to open it and we saw it's a 1 by 5 meter space. It was dark. 12 people were there. So can you imagine already that it's very congested? The people who were there were mixed, female and male, and that's a violation already. In fact, the space alone will tell you. But one of the things that you cannot show on a video is the putrid smell that you witness, no? Mabaho, okay. It's very it's very a foul odor, urine and excrement were already, you know, that was the scent. No? It's very dark, but when you see the 1x5 space there, of course there were camera lights already. And take a look at the end of that particular space, it was dark as well. So if there was, and this is, I'm going into the finding that there was an ingress, egress in that area. But if there were, then why could not have the police directed us to the other side of it? If they said that this bookcase is just here, there's another entry to it, entry to that space, then they could have directed us to that. But there
In short, let's not fool ourselves. There was an effort to conceal or to hide the prisoners or the people being detained there. And what was the reason? Because again, my question is, there seems to be a tendency to focus on the facility, which in itself was a problem, merited the filing of a complaint at the very least, right? But why were they being kept there was another big problem, right?
Yes.
Police were trying to extort money from them, is that correct?
That's the report that we got. As I've said, that actually is supported by the fact that the names were not in the register.
Okay. Now, let's talk about the evidence, because according to the ombudsman, based on the decision, the burden of proof was with the CHR, number one, to prove that there was another available confinement area which was better. So nasa inyo rin burden of proof.
The proof that is needed here was presented, and we believe that this is enough for probable cause, which is the role of the ombudsman. Now, what were the pieces of evidence that we presented? In this case, we have the video. We have the testimony, the unrehearsed testimony, the raw testimonies of these 12 people, who claimed that some of them were there for a week already. And then we also have the psychosocial reports of an expert group of doctors, psychologists, that's the medical action group, that was also presented as a part of the evidence that we submitted to the ombudsman.
So these were not considered in that decision by the ombudsman?
Well, we were hoping that these pieces of evidence will be appreciated more by the ombudsman. And owing to the fact, of course, that it wasn't only the testimony or the affidavits of these 12 people, we also had affidavits of our own investigators who witnessed the proceedings when they were conducting the visit. So owing to the fact that we are also another constitutional body, then we were hoping and we were very hopeful that the ombudsman would have accorded great weight to our submission, including the statements of our investigators, our lawyers, and the regional director as well.
Okay. So what's the next move? What's the next move by the CHR?
Well, motion for reconsideration, we've already filed it, and we're still hopeful. We're not without hope that this case is a lost cause. It's not a lost cause. We have strong evidence. We believe that, and we will fight this till the end. There are other avenues coexisting in exacting accountability, obtaining justice, and access to remedies for the victims. But we are hopeful that in this MR, or motion for reconsideration process, the ombudsman will will appreciate better the evidence that the pieces of evidence that were submitted and will accord great weight to it, owing to the fact that we are also a constitutional body. And again, let me repeat that this is not without evidence. There are several pieces of evidence that were submitted. It's not only testimonial. We have the examinations of doctors who are experts, and we also have the affidavits of those who conducted the surprise visit and the unrehearsed testimonies of the victims who were so relieved when the door was opened, when the bookcase was moved. These detainees were so relieved. People were crying and saying thank you. And they were hopeful that they would be released, actually.
There was no lighting, just to be clear. There was no lighting in that space. Is that correct?
Hardly any lighting at the time. I'm not sure. I think I recall one light bulb, but they said that it was very dark.
Okay.
When the bookcase was there, it was very dark. But
okay.
Just to say that, of course, cameras would need lighting to be able to illuminate what they're trying to take a picture of.
Okay. But was there a separate area in that police precinct where other detainees were being kept, or where those detained in that cramped space behind the bookshelf could have been detained?
Well, yes, there was another space. That was the regular space. That was the official detention cell. In that area. So there is no excuse, really, honestly, because if it was part of their routine, if it was just regular, so why did they try to hide it? Why did they stop Attorney Boisier from moving the bookcase? If there was another entrance to it, then why could they have not directed the team to go the other way?
Okay. Now, let's talk about the implications of this dismissal coming from the Office of the Ombudsman. Of course, you understand that the CHR is trying to perform your mandate. For example, abuses against anyone, not just detainees. It just so happened that this particular case concerned detainees. And somehow, how do you respond to those who are saying that, aren't you being, don't you understand, for instance, that we are in the Philippines and we don't have the perfect facilities as far as detaining people are concerned, that perhaps that was just the best, quote-unquote, that police precinct could have come up with?
Well, you know, we still have to follow certain standards. And those standards is not only confined to a condition or the infrastructure, let's say, of a detention facility. Those standards include rules of procedures which were not followed here. Those standards also call for transparency in their operations as well. And let me just note here that we do have visitorial powers over all places of detention, and this is constitutionally enshrined. So there has to be respect for that. They should have been transparent with us. They should have been forthcoming. So these are the things that we must take a look at. There are human rights standards for what we call the minimum standards for the treatment of persons in custody or persons deprived of liberty. And these were not followed, plain and simple. And one of the standard, well, the standards is also enshrined in our constitution. There is absolute proscription. It's absolutely prohibited to inflict torture, cruel, inhuman, degrading treatment upon anybody, person deprived of liberty. And there is an absolute prohibition against secret detention places.
Okay. Now, with this decision by the Ombudsman, especially this particular part of the decision, quite interesting that there was no showing of bad faith as far as the respondents are concerned. And number two, that you supposedly failed to show that there was another available confinement area which was better. The implications of these portions of that statement when it comes to other police precincts or other police officers who might have been doing the same thing as well?
Well, of course, the implication there is that it really is a setback. It's a setback in our advocacy, in our campaign to ensure that we eliminate illegal, inhumane practices in detention facilities. That is indeed a setback. It also contributes to impunity in the country. If we are not going to be able to correct this, if we're not able to exact accountability for these transgressions that have happened, no? Suffice it to say that, we're really very disappointed, actually. We cannot, express that. We have no words to say when it comes to that. We're extremely disappointed, but again, we are not without hope that this will pan out and this will result in a better appreciation of the evidences that were presented in and submitted with the ombudsman. And the process is not yet final anyway. We still have that motion for reconsideration.
Okay, now if that MR, that motion for reconsideration, is junked as well, what are the other options for the CHR?
Till the end, to the extent of the justice system, we will go to the end of it. So the courts, we will question that and we will see how it goes.
Okay, Commissioner Karen Dumpit, thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you very much, Christian, for the opportunity. Good morning.
The Philippine government will temporarily ban the entry of all travelers from India, which is now struggling to contain a spike in COVID-19 cases. The travel ban will take effect on April 29 until May 14. But Palace spokesman Hari Roque says passengers already in transit from India and those with recent travel history to that country will be exempted. However, they are required to undergo quarantine for 14 days at a facility, even if they previously tested negative for COVID-19. Roque says the transport department should make sure airlines will not allow passengers covered by the travel ban to board flights to the country, except if they are part of the Philippine government's repatriation efforts.
Yung mga restrictions po para sa mga iba pang biyahero na galing sa mga ibang bansa na meron na rin pong variant na galing po sa India ay pwede pong ma-impose ng Office of the President upon the joint recommendation po ng Department of Health at ng Department of Foreign Affairs.
The Philippine lawmakers announced their plans to distribute free samples of the antiparasitic drug ivermectin as treatment for COVID-19. Deputy Speaker Rodante Marcoleta and Anak Kalasugan Party List Representative Mike Defensor will hold an event in Quezon City on Thursday along with doctors who will prescribe the controversial drug. Justice Secretary Minardo Guevara says the two lawmakers are presumed to know what acts are prohibited and allowed under the rules of the Food and Drug Administration. Ivermectin is not yet registered for human treatment in the Philippines, but the FDA earlier granted special permits to several hospitals to use ivermectin for their COVID-19 patients. The first batch of Sputnik V COVID-19 vaccines is set to arrive in the Philippines today. Palace spokesman Hari Roque says the initial 15,000 doses from Russia's Gamaleya Institute will be deployed to Metro Manila because of the vaccine's cold storage requirement of temperatures not exceeding negative 18 degrees Celsius. 485,000 more Sputnik V doses will be delivered to the Philippines on Thursday, the same day more jabs from China's Sinovac are expected to arrive. The Philippine National Police denies fabricating public support for its program, which replicates community pantries. A memorandum purportedly issued by the Regional Police Office in Cagayan de Oro directs police officers to use what it calls planted civilian beneficiaries in their community relations program called Barangayanihan. The PNP spokesperson, Ronaldo Olay says police officers were merely told to submit a report with photos showing them with some of the program's beneficiaries. Olay also insists the program is not designed to compete with community pantries set up by private citizens and organizations. A Philippine lawmaker slams Solicitor General Jose Calida for red-baiting him during the resumption of the Supreme Court's oral arguments on the anti-terrorism law. Mike Navalli reports.
Trust Solicitor General Jose Calida to drop a bombshell each time he faces a big case before the Supreme Court. During his defense of the government's position on the constitutionality of the Anti-Terrorism Act, he red-baited former Bayan Muna Representative Nery Colmenares when he linked him in a raid in Santa Rosa, Laguna, as among the government's victories against communist rebels.
Likewise discovered in the armory were subversive documents, streamers, campaign paraphernalia of Congressman Colmenares, Bayan Muna, and Gabriela, and training materials on advanced revolutionary warfare.
Witnesses and activists who previously occupied the Santa Rosa office raised doubts as to the recovery of firearms and explosives. Colmenares himself did not let it slide.
What's the use, Your Honor, of mentioning my name? This is red tagging then in the end. Your Honor, if in ordinary times red tagging may be considered a libelous statement. But now, Your Honor, red tagging is a deadly offense. It is a threat to life, liberty, and security. The fact that our paraphernalia, if true, were found there, it does not mean we're terrorists. And mentioning us in the opening statement implicates us in that crime, and that is very dangerous for us, Your Honor, and another type of red tagging.
In his opening statement, Calida cited 16 grounds why the petitions against the Anti-Terrorism Act should be dismissed outright. The passage of the law, he says, is a political question which the court cannot look into. It is an exercise of police power to protect the welfare of the people, and the petitioners questioning it have not suffered any direct injury for them to have any standing to challenge the law. Calida even cited effects in formal requisites such as verification and certification. He warned nullifying the law will compromise the country's international economic commitments and will endanger our economic survival. Calida was referring to the anti-money laundering provision under the ATA on the freezing of assets of designated terrorists.
Terrorism must be outlawed in all civilized nations, not explained or rationalized, but fought on and eradicated. My mission as Solicitor General is to see to it that the Anti-Terrorism Act will not be derailed by 37 frivolous lawsuits. Outright dismissal is the only choice available in this case.
But it wasn't Calida himself who faced interpellation by Associate Justice Rosemary Canandang, the only magistrate who managed to ask questions so far. Two of Calida's associates bore the brunt of the questioning, quizzed from the definition of terrorism and inciting to terrorism to arrests and detention under the law. Carandang did not go easy on the issue of giving law enforcers wide discretion in interpreting the law, citing various hypothetical situations.
You are in effect admitting that from the example given, the enforcement officers are now given such a wide discretion in apprehending the suspects based only on his own perception of terrorism.
If that police officer does not have personal knowledge on the intent of that person, he can only apprehend him for violation of common crimes, Your Honor.
Despite the OSG's initial position that the government does not conduct surveillance prior to a court authorization, Carandang managed to have the assistant soldier admit that there is informal surveillance.
Again, is it the government position that no surveillance can be done without the CA authorization?
Yes, Your Honor. As provided for in section, this is one of the safeguards provided for by the ATA. This is provided for in section 16, that no surveillance can be undertaken unless there is a written authorization from the Court of Appeals.
Distinguishing this from the informal surveillance being conducted, which is the basis of the intelligence reports gathered.
Yes, Your Honor. This is communication surveillance, Your Honor.
Carandang also sought clarification on the effect of designation.
Designation per se, Your Honor, cannot lead to an arrest or detention. But this without prejudice to the eventual filing of a prescription case, Your Honor.
I think you are not ready to answer this, but I think the question of the court is very clear. You clarify that in the memorandum that the government will submit.
And if the Anti-Terrorism Council can authorize arrest?
Law enforcers would arrest by virtue of a valid warrantless arrest following the guidelines set forth by Rule 113. If the law enforcers have already effected the arrest and they think that they could not file or the evidence are not yet sufficient for them to validly file a case before the prosecutor's office, then they would have to secure a permission from the ATC so that to detain the person arrested beyond the period contemplated by Article 125 of the revised Penal Code, Your Honor.
So that's the position of the government?
Yes, Your Honor.
And that is not to what is written in the law.
Tuesday's oral arguments was the first conducted online and also Chief Justice Alexander Resmundo's first as top magistrate. The oral arguments will resume on Tuesday. Mike Navalio, ABS-CBN News.
Up next, we'll speak with the Philippines' treatment czar, Leopoldo Bega, the undersecretary from the Department of Health, ahead of today's expected announcement of quarantine restrictions in the so-called NCR Plus bubble. Matters of Fact will be right back.
I'm home.
Filipinos, for example, having a family-oriented culture in the office is a big thing. Having a very collaborative environment or team approach to a lot of things they do is a big thing. Filipinos, even if a lot of folks are not as financially fortunate as our Western counterparts, you would find there's so much into giving.
Welcome back to Matters of Fact. Today, the Philippine government is expected to announce its decision on the possible extension of the modified enhanced community quarantine in the so-called NCR Plus bubble. Some mayors in Metro Manila are in favor of an extension after the current restrictions expire at the end of this month to curb the surge in coronavirus infections.
Hindi po tumataas po yung aming new cases, mga active cases. Pero makikita po natin, hindi rin talaga sumubaba ng gusto. Pero ang maganda po, nagplato po sa amin. So ibig sabihin, na hindi pa po talaga kampante po tayo dito sa Paranaque.
Right. If you ask me, since we've gone through the pain of doing an ECQ, an MECQ, maybe another 1 to 2 weeks MECQ might help flatten it again and bring it back to levels where it was, let's say, February or January.
On Tuesday, more than 7,000 new COVID-19 cases were confirmed in the Philippines. That brings the total number of active cases to over 71,000. But health officials note 22 laboratories did not submit their data on time. 63 new deaths and over 10,000 recoveries were also recorded. Now, the country's COVID-19 treatments are, and Health Undersecretary Leopoldo Bega says, the healthcare utilization rate in Metro Manila has gone down over the past few weeks. But is that enough to relax restrictions next month? Undersecretary Bega joins us this morning. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Christian. Good morning to all the viewers out there.
Okay, before we talk about the COVID quarantine restrictions that are expected to be announced today, I'd like to go to this other important topic first. There are two congressmen who are set to distribute free samples of ivermectin, an antiparasitic drug, for treatment for COVID-19. This is a big issue lately, right? So a lot of people have been using that as prophylaxis as well, not just treatment for COVID-19. Any warning, any piece of advice ahead of this? Is this something that the congressmen should do?
Well, I think primarily the ivermectin has been given a compassionate use from the FDA, and this is coursed through the hospitals. In other words, they have to apply for a compassionate use for ivermectin in terms of giving out to the patients that they would like to. And I think there are already two hospitals right now who are given this compassionate use. Right now, the FDA has been asking the different suppliers of ivermectin to apply to the FDA for a CPR so that they would properly be given the necessary permit in terms of marketing this. And the other thing also, ivermectin is being on a clinical trial. In other words, in some hospitals, ivermectin is already being investigated, and researches are made through a clinical trials in some of these hospitals. I'm sure if the results would be very positive in terms of prophylaxis and even treatment, then the FDA will announce that kind of pronouncement.
Now, pending those findings after the clinical trials, are we supposed to take ivermectin as prophylaxis or treatment for COVID-19?
Well, the FDA has given us the directive that ivermectin is still an investigational and really an experimental drug. In other words, it is not fit for any kind of human consumption, not unless the drug supplier submits the CPR to FDA, so it can be cleared and specified whether this is for human use or for animal use. And that's the only way that this can be marketed to the different constituents.
Okay, and again, for the information of the people, when you say compassionate use, this should be done in a hospital setting, right? With proper monitoring and administration coming from the doctors, right?
Right. It must come from an institution, and the compassionate use for ivermectin will be coursed through the institution from the FDA.
So in this case, can two congressmen, are they supposed to distribute free samples?
They must relate this with the FDA directive, and they can ask actually FDA to look into the supplies of this ivermectin and apply for a CPR, because this is the only way that the FDA can actually give the permit to market this kind of drugs.
Without that, no one, even congressmen, can distribute free ivermectin samples. Is that correct?
Yeah, because first, we don't know if this will be beneficial or it can be harmful to the constituents. So the stand of the WHO, the stand of the FDA and the DOH is that it has to pass through the FDA for permit and for regulation.
Okay, and what do you make of this intense pressure seemingly or lobby for ivermectin to be used as treatment or prophylaxis? Prophylaxis meaning something that could be used supposedly to prevent you from contracting COVID-19, right? So para maiwasan daw, supposedly. But what do you make of this seemingly intense pressure on our regulators to allow ivermectin? Is there something that we are not seeing here?
Right, because there are so many anecdotal reports wherein patients have been cured or they've taken ivermectin as prophylaxis, and they did not have the COVID-19 infection. But these are anecdotal reports. But there are now big randomized clinical trials in all centers, in big centers around the world, wherein they try to find out if the effectivity and safety of ivermectin is there in the treatment and prophylaxis of COVID-19. Not unless we see the final scientific data on the clinical randomized trials of ivermectin on bigger centers, can we clearly say that it is safe and effective, or it can also be harmful.
So better to wait.
Yeah, I think we have to wait for the scientific data coming from the bigger clinical randomized trials abroad.
Okay. Now let's go to this this current COVID-19 restrictions in Metro Manila and nearby provinces. We're under an MECQ setting. And of course, we heard the position coming from the experts and even the DOH. Based on the numbers, are we ready to shift to a less stringent COVID-19 pandemic restrictions in Metro Manila and nearby provinces, or are we not?
Yeah, you know, Christian, when the wave started really in the first week of March, most of the hospitals really were trying to admit non-COVID patients already, because you know that the trend at that time was a decreased trend in the COVID infections. There was only about 1,000 plus to 2,000 plus new cases. But apparently, the wave came in March, and the hospitals really had to adjust and allocate and compress some of their allocated beds for non-COVID to COVID. And this took time. And in fact, we have been giving the direction for most of the hospitals, especially the public and the private, to make sure that the bed allocation for COVID is there, at least 30% for the private and then the 50% for government. And to intensify also the number of ICU beds that they have. And lately, we have gained the grounds on this in terms of making sure that the ICU beds are there to cover the severe and moderate cases. From compared with last month and this month, we have generated at least 150 new beds of ICU. In other words, from 781 last March, we are now 931 in terms of the number of ICUs that we have.
Where's this? In Metro Manila?
This is Metro Manila. We're talking of the level three and level two Metro Manila public and private hospitals. And we also were able to improve the number of isolation beds to 800 plus. So in other words, what I'm saying is that we just gained grounds in terms of making sure that the capacity of the health system is there. And de-escalating this would mean that it is very hard for us to preserve this ground. In other words, we have to continue and maintain preserving the gains that we have right now, because we don't know if we are able to suppress this virus. Because if you take a look at the number of cases, there might be a decrease and even a plateauing, but we have to make sure that we have to be ready for anything that will come. So in other words, at this point, we are making sure that the health system capacity is there.
So better to extend the MECQ or not?
Yeah, I think it is better for us, as the mayors were saying, that we need to preserve our gains right now, because the gains that we have came in later, about the fourth or the third and the fourth and the fifth week. So it's much better that we have this kind of status right now, so we can actually preserve whatever gains that we had lately.
Okay, now you mentioned gains, right? Interesting choice of word. But how about the establishment of a COVID-19 infrastructure that would be able to actually withstand whatever surge that might come in the future?
Yeah, Christian, you know...
When can we achieve that?
We can achieve that in 6 months' time. In 3 months' time, because roughly when we planned for it last November, we knew that there might be a second wave. And we planned for the field modular hospital. And the first field modular hospital that was constructed and operationalized was in a kidney center. That's about 27 beds for intensive care and moderate use. And then after that came Jose Rodriguez. That's another 44 beds for as a field modular hospital. And lately, we had the 110 beds coming from QI, and that's being operated by Jose Reyes. And we are still constructing, through the DPWH, of course, the another 110 extension facility in Kidney Center. That's 110. And there's another 220 in National Mental Hospital. That's a field hospital. So in other words, in 45 days or even three months, we will be able to achieve this number of beds to about close to 500. We're going to inaugurate another 44-bed field modular hospital this Friday in Batangas, and that's in Batangas Medical Center. So these are the, of course, I would like to mention also that through the local government unit, Mayor Isko Moreno took the initiative of setting up a field modular hospital in front of Quirino Grandstand. And that's about 135 beds. For moderate cases.
So you expect to complete all this in 45 days. But if you look at the numbers that we're seeing now, the average, we're somewhere in the vicinity of 6,000 to 9,000 cases daily. So sobrang dami pa rin, no? And those facilities that you mentioned only form part of the overall strategy by the government.
Right.
So what about testing and tracing, for instance? And what are we expected to do within those 45 days while those facilities, that infrastructure is being completed?
Right.
Naka-lockdown ba tayo lahat dyan or not necessarily?
No, not necessarily, Christian. But you know, you have low-lying fruits in here. You have hospitals, institutions, facilities capable of handling severe and moderate and critical patients. All they have to do really, and this is what we've been trying to ramp up, is allocate more intensive care units in their hospitals. In other words, they can easily convert a room into a very specialized unit as an ICU. In other words, they have the structure, they have the monitors, they have the equipment, they have the highly skilled personnel. In other words, these low-lying fruits out there, conversion of some of these rooms, isolation beds, or even wards into isolation facilities really can help out and ramp up the number of ICU beds. And this is what we're saying, that the 150 beds that we were able to generate came mostly from these hospitals that were able to transform a part of their rooms and isolation beds into specialized isolation units called ICUs.
But do they have sufficient personnel to man or to staff those additional facilities?
Yes, because all they have to do is really contract the non-COVID cases and reassign some of their healthcare workers to the specialized units for COVID. But of course, they need to hire more. And this is the reason why the Department of Health has been trying to put up about 3,500 positions for augmentation for the healthcare workers. And
how many have you recruited?
We have recruited almost 2,000 plus. That's almost roughly about 65%. In other words, we're actually generating more of this human resource to man and fill the hospitals that we have. And the second is we do deployment coming from regions that have low risk for COVID. And they have also given us warm bodies being deployed in the different hospitals here in Metro Manila. That's roughly about 170 of them at present.
So as of today, how long is the waiting time if you, let's say, get COVID-19 and then you want to get a hospital bed? How long is the waiting time at the one hospital command center?
The waiting time, you mean the call time or the
I mean you call response. When you call the one hospital command center, how soon can you get a bed?
It really depends in the triage of this kind of patients. If the patient actually is just having a positive, is COVID positive, but is mild and doesn't have any symptoms, then that can easily be coordinated to isolation center by the one hospital command. And if the patient would need an intensive care unit, the patient will be sorted out whether he would want a private or a public institution. If a public institution, there are a number of ICU beds right now. I think the critical HCUR disaggregated for the intensive care unit is now at 71%. And this is better off than the last month since we were having almost 78 to 80% at the time. So in other words, we do have a number of beds right now.
So can you honestly tell the public that if someone is suffering from severe or critical case of COVID-19, that when that person or person's relatives call the one hospital command center, that patient can get an ICU bed?
Of course. Right now, yes. We have about 71% HCUR for the ICU bed. So roughly, they can be accommodated at this time.
They don't have to wait long?
Well, it really depends. In the choice of the patients, the patients would somehow choose a private institution or a level 3 or a level 3 of public institution. But if there's if given the chance, it would be easier for us to coordinate if we can set this up in a government retained institution.
Okay. Health Undersecretary Leopoldo Vega, thank you for joining us this morning, sir.
Salamat, Christian. Thank you.
A court in Manila issues arrest warrants for Philippine State Lottery official Sandra Cam, her son Marco Martin, and five others after they were tagged in the fatal shooting of Batuan Masbate Vice Mayor Charlie Yuson. Yuson was ambushed and killed in Sampaloc, Manila in 2019. The arrest warrants do not give the suspects any right to bail. Cam has denied any involvement. Martin and Vice Mayor Yuson were rivals in the 2019 local elections. The Makati City Prosecutor's Office junks the rape with homicide complaint against 11 respondents in the death of flight attendant Christine De Serra. The criminal complaint was rejected due to lack of probable cause. The Philippine National Police has said in a medical legal report that De Serra died of natural causes after joining a New Year's Eve party with the respondents.
Kahit pa paano, gumana naman ang loob, di ba? Pero sakit pa rin eh.
Now, health officials have said COVID-19 transmissions among family members under one roof are on the rise. Now, what steps should be taken in case this happens to you? Let's hear from Dr. Ana Ong Lim. She's an infectious diseases expert and a member of the Philippine Health Department's Technical Advisory Group. Good morning, Doctor, and thank you for joining us again in the program.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, let's. I was thinking that this interview could serve as purely educational or instructional, especially those who are somehow not familiar with what to do, given the fact that cases involving household members are on the rise, as mentioned in our introduction. So first off, if you get COVID-19, of course you have your family with you, you're staying under one roof. What are you supposed to do? What are the rest of the family supposed to do?
Christian, I think the first and most critical step is actually early isolation. So we typically have this mindset that once we're sick, we want to observe further whether these symptoms will develop into anything significant. But granted that COVID-19 cases are so prevalent now, and if this is presenting as a fever, cough, cold illness, the likelihood is really that somebody would be having COVID is pretty high. The most prudent step is really to isolate early. And then once you're isolated, figure out how you can get tested so that a diagnosis can be established right away. And the next steps for quarantine of your household members can also be implemented.
Okay, now pending testing for that person suspected to have COVID-19, what are the rest of the family supposed to do?
So the family member should also already start thinking about quarantine. Again, working on the assumption that the likelihood is pretty high. The importance of this is part of our responsibility is to try to contain spread. So in as much as we want to provide care for our infected family member, we also need to make sure that we're no longer affecting others by continuing to go around. So the incentive really to get tested right away is so that we have a disposition for the entire household, not just for the person who's starting to have symptoms.
Okay. And when is the best time to get tested? If you suspect that you are sick with COVID-19, let's say you yourself is that person suspected of having COVID-19, or if you are a relative staying under one roof, when is the best time to get tested? And do you need to immediately go for an RT-PCR test?
Okay. So the protocols are slightly different for those with symptoms and the close contacts. The symptomatic individual will have a pretty high likelihood of turning positive because they already have symptoms. And preferably this should be an RT-PCR because the sensitivity is better. But if in case it's not available and you already have symptoms, then the antigen, the rapid antigen test can also provide a fairly reliable result. Siguro yung caveat lang dyan, Christian, is if the patient who is symptomatic opts for a rapid antigen test and the rapid antigen test is negative, this has to be re-verified. So a positive test is acceptable, a negative test has to be re-verified. Now, for those who are quarantined because they don't have symptoms yet, you expect that their tests might be false negative if done too early. So you wait for 5 days, and after that time that the source case in your household turns positive or becomes symptomatic, then you can be tested as well.
So don't get tested earlier than 5 days.
Well, yes, after the exposure, because after the onset of symptoms from your source case, no, because you might be doing it too early and you're just getting a false negative test. But let me add, Christian, it's very important, no, regardless of the result of the contact, they still have to continue with their isolation for 14 days. Because yun nga, we don't know whether at what point you will be turning positive. So maraming nakakampante, they think that if they're negative, they're home free, hindi ano, kailangan pa rin mag-quarantine.
And what are they supposed to wear at home? Of course, I'm talking about face masks or shields, no? For example, talagang you suspect that the family member, pending the result of the, let's say, RT-PCR test, but already showing symptoms. Are they supposed to wear face masks at home? Kasi iba inisip, we are staying under one roof. We are resigned to the fact that we would all get infected.
Ah, okay.
May ganong mentality, di ba?
Yeah, may ganong mindset, no? Pero ganito kasi, important pa rin mag-set ng boundaries, no? Kasi hindi naman natin sigurado that your previous interactions already resulted in an infection for the rest of the household. And of course, we're always very conscious of the fact that even as we say, the majority of cases will be mild or asymptomatic, you really can't tell. And we're also seeing reports of people who are in the younger age group, no comorbidities, and they still succumb to the illness. So anyway, the point is, the sick person needs to be separated out, has to have his own room and bathroom. The rest of the household, no, without symptoms, may interact with each other as usual. But when they're in front of the person who's symptomatic, that person, no, they have to be in masking and preferably also face shields para to minimize the transmission.
Okay, but the reality on the ground is that most of the households in the Philippines do not have that opportunity or setup or infrastructure to provide isolation spaces for a family member sick with COVID-19.
Okay.
Right? So in those situations, what are the family members supposed to do?
Well, that will precisely be a setup for the LGU to transport the positive case to a PTMF. But if in case your LGU allows you to stay home, then your mindset should be, how do I convert my interactions to low-risk transmission category? So that means you minimize the interactions, you keep your distance, preferably at least 1 meter apart, you need to be in a mask and shield when interacting with the other family members. And you keep your time of interaction to a minimum. So basically transforming your apat-dapat rules into the household setting. And paying particular attention, I would add, to ventilation in your household because, of course, the time of interaction will be difficult to manage. And because you're indoors, then you want to be able to make sure that you don't increase the viral load within that particular closed space.
Okay, Dr. Anna Ong Lim, thank you very much for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
And that's our program for... Sorry, buddy. Okay, and that's our program for today. I'm Christian Esquera. You can listen to our interviews again on the ANC Matters of Fact podcast, available on Apple, Spotify, Google, and Stitcher. You can also get other exclusive content on ANC's YouTube channel. Thank you for watching.